What is good, everybody? Welcome back to another My Damn Toys video. Tonight, I have your WWE Extreme Rules 2019 full show review and results for you guys. What I'm going to do is run down the entire card, everything that happened at Extreme Rules 2019, breaking down every single matchup, what I thought about the matches, what I thought about the feuds, where I think the feuds are going to go from here, what I thought of the outcomes, and everything in between. Going into this show, guys, you know that they like to promote Extreme Rules, but usually there's nothing extreme about it. Will it live up to the hype? Let's find out together. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we start off the pre-show, Extreme Rules 2019, with my boy Finn Balor. You guys know I'm a big Finn Balor fan, right? He's defending the IC title versus Shinsuke Nakamura. You guys know in my predictions video, I called out WWE for not putting my boy on the show. They didn't even have Finn Balor on this show as of 2 days ago, and then they just randomly dropped it on us that we were getting this matchup on the pre-show of all places. Both of these guys deserve to be on the main show, but you know, I guess they gotta stick somebody there. Why not start off hot with these two talents that are absolutely some of the best in the world, right? So we stuck them out there, and you know, Finn Balor defending the IC title. I was like, you know what, last minute matchup. They're just sticking this match on the card just to, you know, have their IC champion featured on this Extreme Rules pay-per-view. They left him off of last show. They haven't featured him on SmackDown for weeks until this past week, and you know, it'd be a really, you know, they really do need to feature him here. So he defends the title, and he loses. Finn Balor loses. There's Shinsuke Nakamura, new Intercontinental Champion. And I actually enjoyed the matchup, not gonna lie. Not gonna lie to you, I was enjoying the matchup. I hate the commercials in between, you know, with the pre-show and the USA Network. But god dang, I don't know what to think, man. I mean, there's a few ways I'm looking at it, because you have a little bit of ways you can look at this thing. Shinsuke Nakamura winning the IC title, cool, great for Shinsuke. You know, I think he deserves, you know, a title belt, mid-card championship. But Finn Balor, you know, he just got the title. Like, my god, like, he just got the title at WrestleMania, you know, and he hadn't really done much with it. And so I was hoping for a nice little reign for him here. That didn't happen. But we just saw Samoa Joe lose the U.S. title and go straight into the WWE title program. So maybe Finn Balor loses here. Maybe he turns heel and goes after Rollins for SummerSlam for a rematch from 2016. That would be some pretty good ish right there. So I don't know. We're going to see what happens, but I'm not happy about him losing the IC title. You know, I don't like it at all. You know, I love Finn Balor to death, so I don't like that. But you know what? It is what it is, man. Shinsuke Nakamura, your new Intercontinental Champion. Next up, guys, we had the second matchup of the pre-show for Extreme Rules, and it was the Cruiserweight Championship match between Drew Gulak and Tony Nese, and I was looking forward to this one. I love Gulak. I'm a big fan of his, and I like Tony Nese a lot. Both of them can go. You know, I expected some good stuff out of this matchup, and that's what they gave us. You know, nothing too crazy off the wall, but it was a good representation of what 205 Live is all about. Good, solid wrestling here and a great matchup. It was quicker than I thought it would be, but Drew Gulak does retain the Cruiserweight Championship, and I'm a fan of this. I like Drew Gulak a lot, and I'm a fan of his, and I think that this is good stuff here. Continue his reign. He was super over, man. The crowd was chanting for him, and you know, the crowd was into it, and I enjoyed it. So Drew Gulak does retain the Cruiserweight Championship, and I am okay with this. So surprisingly, guys, we started off Extreme Rules 2019 with the big marquee matchup that they've been pushing all week long, these weeks leading up to Extreme Rules, The Undertaker and the Big Dog, the Graveyard Dogs, as dumb and as stupid as that tag team name is, taking on Shane McMahon and Drew McIntyre. You guys know how I felt about this feud coming in. Shane McMahon is just, you know, he's stale. Just, my God, everybody's just sick of seeing this man on our televisions. But coming into this matchup, guys, I didn't give a single F about this match. I literally couldn't give less of a damn. I did not care who won. I wasn't invested. But by the time this freaking match ended, I was super just into it. I was super excited. I loved it. I was into it. Undertaker hasn't looked that good in a match in a very long time, guys. You compare Undertaker and Goldberg to this matchup, you would think that this was two different men wrestling as far as the Undertaker is concerned. This match was fire, guys. This matchup was fire. The crowd was fire. They were super into it. I think the timing, the pacing, the spots, from an entire standpoint, I think they hit every single aspect of it. I think they did a really terrific job in this matchup. I was really entertained the whole way through, and the crowd kept me in it as well, man. I think they did a fantastic job, and I want to apologize personally to not only WWE, but every man involved in this matchup for just, you know, my mindset coming into this matchup. However, you know, I guess it's not technically my fault when they weren't really giving me a reason to be excited for this matchup, but they totally, with just surpassed my expectations for it. And if you guys missed this matchup, I highly, highly suggest you go back and check it out. We had some really cool spots in this no-holds-barred matchup. Announce table, steel steps. We even had some good cinematography in this thing with the ending sequence with the spear. And then, of course, our tombstone to Shaming Man. I mean, really good stuff, man. I really did enjoy this matchup. Great way to start the show on fire. And it was just a great way to start Extreme Rules. Taker and Roman do defeat Shaming Man and Drew McIntyre. So please, God, can we end this feud? I don't want to see Shane McMahon anymore during weekly television. Next up, guys, we had the Raw Tag Team Championship match between The Revival and The Usos. A matchup that I was very much looking forward to. Two of the best teams in the world, in my personal opinion. And honestly, I was thinking to myself, what the hell is Vince McMahon doing putting on two tag team matches in a row? I bet that man's freaking the hell out right now. But I was excited for this match coming in. What is Scott Dawson doing, man? The jacket's trying to cover his face there. Show your ugly face there, Chief. Come on. So I was excited for this matchup coming in, guys, and I think they totally delivered. I had a bunch of people on my Twitter feed telling me that this match was too long and that, you know, it just went on too long, but I'm just happy to see The Revival and The Usos on the main show. I'm happy to see them get some time to put on a good wrestling match for us, and I enjoyed this matchup. I enjoyed The Revival versus The Usos. I don't think it was everything they could have given us. I thought there was some great chemistry. I thought there was some great tag team wrestling put on display here, some great near falls, a terrific ending there with the Shatter Machine coming out of nowhere. I really did enjoy this matchup. The Revival do retain, which I am glad they are retaining the championships. I think they deserve a nice lengthy run with the Raw tag straps, and it was cool to see here them versus the Usos. It was a solid matchup. I enjoy it, and the Revival do retain their Raw tag team titles. Next up, guys, we have the singles match between Cesaro taking on Aleister Black. I was very excited for this one as well. On paper, you know, this has the makings of a match of the night candidate between both of these guys. They can absolutely work. They're both fantastic guys. And this one wasn't, you know, anything crazy, much like Revival and Usos. You know, nothing over the top special, but it was good. It was very nice. I enjoyed it. Aleister Black and Cesaro, obviously some good chemistry between the two. And I enjoyed this matchup, man. Aleister Black wins. I think he should have won. I think this is the right move. I think they're trying to build Aleister Black up, which is, I think, you know, how Ricochet and Aleister Black were on the same team when they first got to the main roster, and we were all just, you know, like ready for them to be single stars and ready for them to be single stars. You know, they needed that singles push, and now both of them are going their separate ways. Ricochet's your U.S. champion coming into tonight, and Aleister Black is also looking good as singles competition winning here. So they're doing a really good job, guys, and I'm really happy that Aleister Black wins here, and hopefully they're trying to build up both of those guys. But here he wins in a great matchup with Cesaro, and yeah, it was good stuff. Next up, guys, we have the SmackDown Live Women's Championship between Bayley taking on Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross in a 2-on-1 handicap match. And you guys already know how I feel about this feud, about this storyline, about all of this. I'm not a fan of it. I don't like these two together. They just don't click with me. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, Nikki Cross was, you know, in NXT, she was a separate entity, like two totally different characters. And I know the main roster in NXT are completely different. Like, Alexa Bliss and her just don't mesh, man. It just doesn't fit for me. And it doesn't work well. And Bayley going against them, I just wanted her to win this matchup and move on to better things. You know, I tried to fantasy book this, and I said, you know what, it'd be cool after the match, Bayley retains, have Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross beat the hell out of Bayley, be beating her down, Sasha Banks come back, you know, triumphant return, comes down, gets the save, helps Bayley out versus these two, and then she turns heel on Bayley. You don't even have to do it at this show. You can wait a couple weeks, build it up like this is a tag team effort, and then have her turn on Bayley, leading to their SummerSlam matchup, tying back to all the work they've done together over the past 2 years, all the crap they've been through, tying back to NXT. Would have been beautiful, but they didn't book it that way. They just had Bayley retain, and that was it, and nothing cool, nothing, over the top, or no cool booking ideas here, or Sasha Banks returning. So I really don't know where they're going from here. I still think Sasha Banks should be the plan for Bayley for SummerSlam, but who the hell knows, honestly, at this point. Nothing too special about this matchup. Bayley does retain her championship, thank Christ, and hopefully we can get her a good challenger in here. I would prefer Sasha, but this matchup was definitely better than the matchup they had at Stomping Grounds. Next was the last man standing match between Jan Strowman and Bobby Trashley here at Extreme Rules. Guys, probably the most extreme match to this point, and it was pretty entertaining, I'm not going to lie. I mean, coming in this matchup, I didn't expect much. You guys know how I feel about Jan Strowman. Ship sailed on him a long, long time ago. He's just the same guy, just knocking stuff over and being boring and blah, blah, blah. Bobby Trashley can't talk on the mic, and he hasn't done much either. You know, I don't know, man. Just not my favorite wrestlers here, but But you know what? They had my interest throughout the matchup. They had some cool spots going all over the arena. I think was the right call here. And I actually was kind of excited here because I thought that they would do power moves. I thought they would, you know, do extreme stuff. And they actually delivered. I wasn't in love with the matchup, but I thought it was pretty cool. There was some dead space here and there, but overall it did keep my interest. And I enjoyed the match for what it was. And Jan Strowman actually defeats Bobby Trashley. And I thought maybe, you know, they would give Bobby Trashley a rub since he was, you know, he pretty much buried Rey Mysterio on Monday Night Raw, but I guess they were just doing that so that Bobby Trashley had some momentum coming into this matchup. But Jan Strowman does defeat Bobby Trashley, and I'm glad. Hopefully this feud is over. Next up, guys, we have the SmackDown Live Tag Team Championship triple threat match between Daniel Bryan and Rowan versus Heavy Machinery versus The New Day. And coming into this matchup, I was looking forward to this one, man. I mean, these three teams can go, and they have some great chemistry together. And they proved it here tonight, man. WWE putting some great emphasis on tag team wrestling, and it was absolutely beautiful. Isn't it beautiful when you put emphasis on tag team wrestling? I mean, my Lord God. This matchup was fantastic. I really enjoyed it. Again, just thoroughly entertained throughout, and I thought Rowan and Daniel Bryan should have won here. I thought they were going to win, and then out of nowhere, guys, The New Day are your new champion, six-time tag team champion New Day. So now we have The New Day with the blue straps, and will Kofi retain his WWE championship later? That's going to be the question coming in here, and it's absolutely insane that, you know, that they lost the titles. I did not expect Rowan and Bryan to drop the tag titles. I was really enjoying them as a team, and I thought they were doing well, but you know what? They put the tag titles on New Day, and I don't know how to feel about it exactly, but I guess we'll see where we go from here. Next up, guys, was the United States Championship match between Ricochet and AJ Styles. We all knew that this matchup was going to be impressive. You know, they gave it to us twice on free TV, which I did not like. I wish they would have kept these guys apart. It would have been a lot better seeing them get in the ring here. It would have been a lot more epic. But nonetheless, they did come in here. They had a great matchup, back and forth, great sequence system, amazing athleticism from Ricochet, as we come to know for this man. I mean, everybody knows how good he is, how athletic this man is, just flying all over the ring. You know, the club was at ringside trying to cause havoc, and that is ultimately what costs Ricochet here in this matchup. Carl Anderson tries to get involved. Ricochet fights him off. He goes up to the top, but while the ref is looking at Carl, Luke comes from behind, shoves Ricochet. He hits his nuts on the turnbuckle. AJ Styles would go up to the top, hits a Styles Clash from the top turnbuckle or the mid turnbuckle, whatever. It was a super Styles Clash. Puts away Ricochet, 1, 2, 3, and AJ Styles is your new United States champion. And this totally shocked me, guys. I guess they just want to, you know, have these guys fulfill like a series of matches, I guess, is where they're trying to go with this. You know, have maybe another matchup at SummerSlam, or maybe another guy gets involved in this or something. But I'm totally shocked that AJ Styles won. I predicted this in my setup. I didn't predict it in my predictions. I thought that Ricochet would totally win here and have AJ Styles put him over, but that is not the case here tonight. With Ricochet losing his United States Championship, this is crazy. I mean, I enjoyed the matchup. Very good matchup here, much like the rest of the card, besides, you know, the women's match. Everybody knew this matchup would be great, and it totally lived up to the hype, and maybe they'll give it to us again. I just don't want it on free TV, man. Let it build up some tension. But nonetheless, AJ Styles is your new United States Champion. I know we didn't take the titles off of Rowan and Daniel Bryan, but you know what? It's too late now. We'll put the championship on AJ Styles. There you go. New United States Champion, the phenomenal AJ Styles. Next up, guys, we had a matchup between two of my favorite wrestlers in the world, Kevin Owens taking on Dolph Ziggler, and this matchup was announced maybe like a couple hours before the show even started, so I figured what happened on this show between these two would happen between these two on the show, because Dolph Ziggler uploaded like something to his Twitter, and he was talking about how WWE paid him to come out, and you know, he accepted some challenge from Kevin Owens. But anyway, the bell rings, stunner to Ziggler, and the matchup's over. I figured something like this would happen, so I kind of prepared myself mentally for it, and that is why I'm not too disappointed in it. You know, they just treat Ziggler like shit. I wish he would just not re-sign and go somewhere where they treat him better, but you know, it is what it is. At least it was Kevin Owens, somebody that I love. You guys know that I cherish Kevin Owens, so I wasn't that upset upset about it, even though it does suck. Kevin Owens gets on the mic after the matchup and calls out Shane McMahon again, you know, trying to destroy him on the microphone. Totally does, and he just proves another reason why he's one of the best in the world. I'll say it on a weekly basis, on a daily basis. You guys know how I feel. I don't know where they're progressing to. Maybe we get like a grudge match between Shane and Kevin at SummerSlam. Move on from Roman Reigns. Get Kevin Owens versus Shane McMahon after their long rivalry, you know, dating back to last year. And get these guys in a freaking epic fight at SummerSlam. I think that would be very epic and very entertaining. I know that Kevin Owens would deliver much better in a matchup of that sort outside of The Miz versus Shane McMahon. So I think it would be really, really entertaining. So maybe that's what we'll get moving forward. And I just am sick of... Then again, I'm sick of seeing Shane McMahon. My God. But if it's going to result in Kevin Owens destroying him on the microphone every week, I think I can get behind it. Next up, guys, we had the WWE Championship match between Kofi Kingston and Samoa Joe. And coming into this matchup, I really have enjoyed Kofi Kingston's run. I'm not going to lie, they booked him super strong. I mean, he has overcome multiple talents. He's looked good in all his matches. He's put on a good match with, I'm pretty sure, every single person that he stepped in the ring with during his reign as champion since WrestleMania. And he's done very well for himself. But coming into this matchup, I really, 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 really wanted Samoa Joe to win this WWE Championship. He's been so close so many times, and they pull the rug out from under him every single time. And just like they do every time, they did it again here, and Samoa Joe loses, and it was a good matchup. I enjoyed the matchup all the way through, and they ruin it. I would have loved to seen Samoa Joe win here, but again, they fail me, and now I'm upset, and I'm worried that they're not... I mean, where does Joe go from here? He lost the U.S. title after barely doing anything with it. He was thrust into the WWE title picture, and he lost that immediately. So, I mean, I don't know where he goes from here. Where the hell does Samoa Joe go from here? There's nothing he can do unless he says, you know... I mean, he was beaten clean. There's nothing he can say. I mean, maybe he gets a rematch. I don't know. I don't know where the hell they go from here, but He didn't do nothing here. He didn't do nothing, and he is not your WWE champion. And also, my Uncle Tim looks like Samoa Joe, and I thought it was time to crown Uncle Tim here at Extreme Rules 2019. But Kofi Kingston retains the WWE title, and who's going to be his next challenger? I guess we'll have to find out and see. And for our main event, ladies and gentlemen, we had the Mixed Extreme Rules Tag Team Match, winner take all for the Universal and Raw Women's Championships here between two of my favorite wrestlers, Seth Rollins and Becky Lynch, taking on two of my least favorite wrestlers, Lacey Evans and Trash Corbin. And I gotta say, guys, I was not looking forward to this. I can't stand the relationship angle that's been going on. You guys kind of know how I feel about that. And you guys know how I've been feeling about it. It's just really just cringy sort of on TV. They don't have really good on TV, you know, chemistry. And this matchup wasn't the best. You know, Lacey's super green in the ring, and I just do not enjoy her work. Trash Corbin, I just don't like either. And I mean, I think the only good part about this matchup was the ending when Baron Corbin hits an end of days on Becky Lynch, which I really popped for. I thought that was awesome to see. And then Seth Rollins just comes unglued, man. Just starts beating the hell out of him with a kendo stick, beats the hell out of him with a chair, 3 curb stomps, and then he pins him to win the matchup. As soon as the matchup ends, guys, in comes Brock Lesnar, and he comes out there with Paul Heyman, and he cashes in his Money in the Bank contract. He actually cashed in, and Seth Rollins is down F5. I thought he would kick out, kind of make it, you know, sort of like, you know, just try to be somewhat of competitive. Now that's it, Brad. We have a new Universal Champion, and it is back on the beast. The Brock party will continue into the biggest party of the summer, and we are going to have Brock Lesnar. I don't know who's Brock Lesnar going to challenge for. I mean, we knew it was coming, guys. We knew it was coming. Hopefully, he doesn't hold the championship hostage like he does. I don't know what to think, man. I really don't, because I don't know who they're trying to set up. Are we going to have Rollins versus Lesnar again? Like, that doesn't sound logical. Are we going to have Roman versus Brock? That doesn't sound logical. That's the same. That would be the same exact matchup that we would have from last year's SummerSlam, right? Where Roman finally captured the Universal Championship. So I don't know where they're going, man. I really do not know where they're going with this. And I'm pretty sure they're not going to bring Goldberg back after that trash we saw at Super Showdown. So yeah, guys, I really don't know where they're going with it. It's going to be interesting to see. We're going to watch Monday Night Raw tomorrow night. Maybe we're going to have Rollins versus Lesnar. I don't know. We'll see what happens on Monday Night Raw. But Brock Lesnar is your new Universal Champion. And I thought overall Extreme Rules was a really solid show, guys. All the matches except for maybe Alexa Bliss and Bayley, the main event, Overall, very good show, man. I mean, I wish I would have seen Samoa Joe get a dub here, but, you know, it is what it is. We're going to watch Monday Night Raw and SmackDown Live, but this show had a good fire under it. I enjoyed a lot of the matches, a lot of the work here tonight. And, yeah, Beast in the Bank is no longer Beast in the Bank. He's Beast in the Universal Championship. So, that's it for this video, guys. Thank you guys so much for watching my review. Comment down below what you thought of Extreme Rules 2019. Subscribe to the channel for more epic WWE figure videos. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter at my name, Toys, and I will see you guys in the next video. Thank you.